Good morning. Today I'm going to be talking about schizophrenia, a subject avoided by many yet affects even more. First, I want to lay a foundation of what cell communication is. Its main purpose is for cells to send and receive signal chemical messages in order to coordinate actions of distant tissues, cells, and organs. Maybe you need to know is what three signal transduction pathways are, but they are the reception, signal transduction, and finally response. I'm just going to explain them through this diagram. Okay. So first you have a signaling molecule, and what it does is it binds with a receptor and it goes through transduction, which activates a series of enzyme molecules, and then finally it reaches response, which activates the cellular response. Okay, historically speaking, mental illness was first seen as a punishment as well as a supernatural cause and even demonic. Treatments differ from exorcism, bloodletting, which we know as phlebotomies, and even lobotomies, and when asylums were opened in 1750s, the mentally ill people were placed in there so that their families would take care of them. This all occurred into 460 and 337 BC when Hippocrates, with the Greek physician, had said that mental illness was an object of scientific speculation, and we know him as father of medicine, as well as how he introduced us to Hippocratic Oath, which is taken by physicians and other medical people. An example of what a bloodletting is, which we know is phlebotomy, as well as a doctor explaining lobotomy. The history of schizophrenia can be traced back to Egypt, but I want to mainly focus on Dr. Emil Kraepelin in 1887 when he first called it dementia praecox, which means early forms of dementia, but this was for patients who had shown signs and symptoms of schizophrenia. But in that same year, he did label this mental disorder as schizophrenia. He just said that it had accompanied people throughout history, so therefore there's no one specific person recorded for this mental illness. Inside schizophrenia. It's located the effects in the prefrontal cortex as well as your temporal lobe, and the chromosome effective is 22, which is known as 22q11 deletion. As you can see in this diagram, the yellow represents the microdeletion, meaning the missing genetic material. As you can see in this DNA strand, there is a missing part of the DNA strand in the middle. This is just an example of what the chromosome 22 is. It's contracted environmentally and through genetics. There are five different types known as paranoid, disorganized, catatonic, undifferentiated, and residual. Most common in the US though is paranoid. Schizophrenia is a chronic long-term disorder, which means that there is no cure. It affects 1 out of 100 people, and it affects your thoughts, behavior, and emotions. And it's inappropriate relationship into fantasies and delusions. And the word comes from the Greek word schizo, meaning split, and free, meaning mind. You put them together, you get split mind. And the misconception that usually people have is that schizophrenic patients have a split personality as well. This is not true. It just means that they have fragmented thinking. Everyone has an equal chance of being diagnosed with this mental disorder, but men usually get diagnosed in their early 20s, whereas women get diagnosed in their late 20s to early 30s. And if you're diagnosed before the age 18, it's thought as early onset. That's why it's early onset.
You can tap over the left and it'll advance you if you need to.
It is uncommon to be diagnosed before the age 12 and after the age 40. But however, with this being said, in 2014 there was a case reported of a young girl who's 11 named Jamie Shufield, and she had signs and symptoms of schizophrenia. And when she was treated for these signs and symptoms, she showed great progress and is now living a healthy life. A few signs and symptoms are disorganized and or compulsive behavior, anger, aggression, delusions, hallucinations, fatigue, paranoia, and even impaired motor coordination. Schizophrenia being diagnosed is very difficult due to the fact that it's a mental illness. So MRIs, CT scans, and blood tests won't show up on those tests, but it can rule out physical abnormalities. But it has been shown that PET scans have been a a better chance for this because they show a more advanced imaging of the brain. And the procedures that you have to go through to be diagnosed is first you have to go through a physical exam, then you get testing and screening, and finally a psychiatric evaluation. A synapsis is a structure that permits neurons to pass electrical and chemical signaling to another neuron. So in the synaptic marker level, the reason that the levels are so high in a healthy brain is because there's no disruptions in the signaling or connections, so they can connect with one another. But in schizophrenia brain, they're slower due to the fact there is disruptions in connectivity and signaling. Treatments, there are, the first one is antipsychotics, which are usually given to a patient who is showing signs and symptoms of acute schizophrenic episode, and what it does is it blocks off the dopamine chemical to the brain, and this leads to reduction in anxiety and aggression, and for the bigger ones like hallucinations and delusions, it takes a little bit longer, like a few weeks. And you only use these until the schizophrenic episode has passed. Another form of treatment is psychological treatments, and that's like therapies. So you have cognitive behavioral therapy, which is for the patient themselves to have to cope with their disease and their thoughts and symptoms. The family therapy is for the families to cope with it, and this because when you take care of a loved one, it puts a lot of stress on the family. And finally, art therapy is for the patient to be able to communicate or express how they feel through a nonverbal way. And also you're in a group, so they find out that they're not alone. Self-communication disorder. First off, I want to say what a healthy human brain is. What it does is it sends and receives signals to the whole body. And what it does is it controls our emotions, our speech, our movement, behavior, thoughts, basically our everything we do. The prefrontal cortex is what helps us plan and our personality developments. Our temporal lobe is what helps us to identify objects, people, and our speech and hearing. And then our dopamine is a neurotransmitter which is released when we feel excited or shocked or anything like that. And our ventricles are what we have that is our cavities that are filled with our cerebrospinal fluid. Okay, this is just a picture of a healthy brain when the disruption of the signaling doesn't occur. But in a schizophrenic patient, there's only one pathway due to the fact that there's a disruption in that pathway, so it can't get to all the other ones, so that's why they're all not red. The cause of schizophrenia is unknown, but it's thought to be a combination of environmental and genetics, and the cell communication breakdown itself is when cells provide protection and support of neurons, and they're taken from schizophrenia patients and are highly dysfunctional. And the development of the cells that assemble the myelin, which are known as oligodendrocytes, were delayed and did not create enough insulation around the cells, causing the signal transmission to be impaired. The main dopamine pathway to the brain is it working, thus decreasing the dopamine projection to the lower prefrontal cortex, and is responsible for negative and depressive symptoms of schizophrenia. This is just an example of it. So what happens is you take a protein and it binds to the neuron and it's supposed to send synaptic imbalance signals to another neuron, and it gives you normal gamma. What that does is it makes our neurons' excitability stay controlled, so that's why everything functions smoothly. But when you take it up in a schizophrenic patient, you have a protein bind to the neuron and something disrupts that signaling. So what it does is it sends synaptic imbalance impulses to a neuron, which enhances the gamma, which enhances our excitability of our neurons, which is why everything goes haywire in the brain. And finally, I just wanted to say a few things that are affected in the end. So what happens is in the brain, the ventricles enlarge, the white matter decreases by 25%, the frontal temporal lobe is showing signs of thinning, and the greater observed changes there are, the greater the auditory illusions there are. Yeah. This is just last comparison. All the tissue is dead, whereas in healthy brain, it is still very deep and long. That's just the difference. Conclusion, let me just stop here. In conclusion, research researchers in the past have only been able to study schizophrenia through postmortem brains. Well, recently, through experiments, they have been able to test on living brains. And with this, they have made a new tracer, which is a chemical or biological property that binds to a protein, and it sends out impulses that a PET scan can pick up. And it shows that, when they look back, it showed that there are lower proteins in the frontal lobe of a schizophrenic patient compared to a healthy brain. So this can, you know, help us to identify what could be a schizophrenia patient compared to a healthy brain. And the last thing is, I just wanted to look over my board. So the green I did, it represents mental illness, and the silver represents schizophrenia. And yeah, that basically sums it up. And there's just other few facts about people that you may know who have it and all. And these are just pictures of things like art therapy from schizophrenia patients.